Good morning and welcome to worship today. Might be a little dreary outside still, but the sun is here with us today, and we are glad of that. Welcome for those of you who are on site, and welcome to those of you online. It is a great opportunity for us to worship, especially today. It is really grateful to see that Tony Kaysen is able to be here after his heart surgery and things. It's beautiful to be able to see Tony and his family back in worship. Welcome. A special welcome to you. As we begin worship, I want to share with you something that I want you to keep in your prayers throughout worship. Our dear friend Jan Kreil will be entering hospice care tomorrow. Though they cannot predict those types of things, we all understand what hospice care means in our world today. So just hold Jan and Joanne in special prayers and the days and the weeks that are due. There are several announcements just to remind you of. This coming Sunday, so next week, we'll be back at First Presbyterian Church. It's been about 6 weeks since we've been there because of some remodeling in the sanctuary, not really remodeling, just repair work. And hopefully you won't notice anything different. That means they did their restorative work just fine. But we'll be back there for the next 2 weeks. And then on the 29th, we have a special worship opportunity in the park, Union Park, just down from First Presbyterian Church. We'll be worshiping out there. Bring your own chairs. Or blanket if you like to sit on the ground. Bug spray is usually a good thing as well. And then also a side dish or dessert to pass. The church will provide a main course. We'll have some games for kids, but there's all sorts of other additional exciting things. So I encourage you to bring, if you go to school particularly, you might have a backpack or something. Bring that backpack with you, but some of us who may not be traditional slaves may still have a computer bag that we carry around with us, or I'm just looking at, you know, Brittany's got this knit bag that you may not carry that regularly, but as a teacher, I'm sure you carry something. So whether any sort of a bag that you carry, if I don't care if it's your bowling ball bag or something, bring it because we're going to have a special blessing of those things, because they're a sign and a symbol of what we do in our life, whether that's school or work or fun, and we'll have a special time to bless those items as a sign of blessing us to go into our world outside of just this moment. We'll also have the opportunity in some different ways to celebrate baptism, but the main reason we're getting together is we're going to celebrate 130 years of the ministry of St. John's United Church of Christ. We have, thanks to the work of Steve Cole, we've uncovered the time capsule, and we will open that time capsule. We've invited the past pastors that serve there that are still living, and only one is able to make it, but the others are sending special greetings and things, so we will just celebrate the ministry that St. John's continues to have in Peace UCC, but also that wonderful opportunity when it went there on 15th and Marshall. So bring some extra friends with you. Just let's have a good time out there. If the weather is not so hot, and I don't mean that, I hope it's not so hot, but you know, if it's inclement, we'll just come that half block or one block right over, and we'll meet at First Presbyterian. So you're still going to drive to the same place, except the weather's not great, and park there and come right inside the building. So it will be a wonderful time. We continue to celebrate our community dinners every Wednesday. This Wednesday, in particular, we need some extra help. We have a simple meal plan, but due to a lot of different circumstances, our three main cooks are not available. So if you can make hamburgers, and you know, making them in the oven, not having to grill too much stuff. But if that's something that you can do and help with other prep work, Please let me know either after service or even easier for my brain is to send me a text or an email or to write it down and put it in the offering plate. Because I'm just going to be honest that sometimes things right after work disappear between now and Monday morning. That happens to me. So any way that you can help out, and again, particularly this wonderful. So let us continue our time in worship. And Gary, why don't you lead us in our call, or our gathering call to worship.
Please join me in our gathering today. Our world offers many wide avenues to walk.
God invites us to walk the road of service and of sacrifice.
Our society suggests we put down roots in the shallow soil of pleasure and greed.
Our God seeks to plant us on the banks of hope, watered by the rivers of joy and grace.
Our culture promotes success, climbing to the top and winning the prize.
Our God tells us if we want to be first, we need to go to the end of the line.
Come, let us worship the Lord.
As we follow love into the world.
Let us pray. Magnificent Lord, you have created so much beauty in the world, we can scarcely take it. Help hear your voice above the sounds of creation so that we may hear your calling. You have placed us in this moment where we are hesitant to walk into the future. So much is unknown, and what is known scares us. Help us to trust in you so that we may face obstacles before us, no matter how giant they may be.
Amen. Friends, if you are able, I invite you to stand in body or spirit and let us sing together. Do not be dismayed.
Thank you.
taking care of each and every one of us, even if we may not recognize it, we are in the palm of God's hand. Now is the time where we can joyfully declare to each and every person around us, whether that be on site or through social media, we worship online, that God's peace is present in our lives and in their lives and in the world. So I encourage you to turn to those around you, greet them with the peace of Christ, verbally flash them the peace signs, let them know that they are loved and welcomed and God's presence is in. And when you're done, please be seated.
Please join me in your hearts as I pray our prayer for illumination. Send your spirit among us, O God, as we meditate on your love. Prepare our minds to hear your word above our hearts. Move our hearts to embrace what we hear and strengthen our will to follow your way. This we pray through Christ our Savior.
Amen.
Listen for God's words today in Numbers chapter 13, verses 30 to 33, and chapter 14, verses 1 through 10. Now Caleb calmed the people before Moses and said, "We must go up and take possession of it, because we are more than able to do it." But the men who went up with him said, "We cannot go up against the people, because they are stronger than we." They started a rumor about the land that they had explored, telling the Israelites, "The land that we crossed over to explore is a land that devours its residents. All the people we saw in it were huge men. We saw there Nephilim, the descendants of Anak. More Anak come from the Nephilim. We saw ourselves as grasshoppers, and that's how we appeared to them." The entire community raised their voice, and the people wept that night. All the Israelites criticized Moses and Aaron. The entire community said to them, "If only we had died in the land of Egypt, or if only we had died in the desert. Why is the Lord bringing us to this land to fall by the sword? Our wives and our children will be taken by force. Wouldn't it be better for us to return to Egypt?" So they said to each other, "Let us pick a leader and let's go back to Egypt." Then Moses and Aaron fell on their faces before the assembled Israelite community. But Joshua, Nun's son, and Caleb, Jephthah's son, from those who had explored the land, tore their clothes and said to the entire Israelite community, "The land we crossed through to explore is an exceptionally good land. If the Lord is pleased with us, he'll bring us into this land and give it to us. It's the land that's full of milk and honey. Only don't rebel against the Lord and don't be afraid of the people of the land. They are our prey. Their defense has deserted them, but the Lord is with us. So don't be afraid of them." But the entire community intended to stone them.
Friends, this is the love of God. We rejoice. I invite all the young who may be with us today to join Miss Brittany for a special time.
Good morning. Well, I think today's weather is actually pretty perfect for what we're going to be talking about today. I wanted to talk about letting the light in. Is it a very bright and shiny day today? Is it really bright and shiny outside? Or is it kind of dreary? Rainy? think those are the sorts of days where it might be the hardest to remember that we are in the light, especially when we come from summer days where it's bright and it makes the rooms all hot if you have the shades open. So this summer, we've had a lot of really strange days. Some days have been really, really bright, and some days have been really, really cloudy. But no matter what, we saw the sun at least some point every day, right? I think what's really important to remember is that it's going to keep going every single day. The sun comes up every single morning, and it goes down every single night. And that's kind of the way that God's love is with us. Even if we don't see it, or sometimes it looks a little bit extra dreary, or sometimes it might be really, really bright. We could just bask in it. It keeps us warm. It keeps us happy and growing. And other times, it kind of just rains on us. And we're kind of stuck in the mud. And I think all of us, whether we're younger or older, still need some help remembering to ask if we get stuck in one of those rain clouds. Do you guys like to pray with me this morning? Dear God, help me remember that I can ask for help. Help me see those around me that can help me see your love when it is too cloudy for me to see. Amen. Now today we're going to do a little activity in our classroom about letting some light in. Are you ready?
I can't wait to see after church what you learned about letting the light in. You ever been overwhelmed? I guess that's really kind of a silly question, isn't it? I mean, of course you have. We're all human. We've all been overwhelmed by life at some time. Life is often overwhelming, and it's easy for us to feel like those Israelite spies in the story that we read today, that we are just mere tiny little grasshoppers, and life is ready to bring that giant foot down on us and squash it. Sure feels that way a lot. Israel, you remember, had been wandering in the wilderness for this 40-year journey, trying to get to the promised land. Someday, God kept saying, you're going to get there. I'm going to give to you this land. There it was. Perhaps right before them. But before their hope and dreams of that land, there was also fear. Fear of the unknown as they approached this promised place. They saw that the land before them was filled with danger. The land was filled with obstacles that for many of them seemed insurmountable. If they were going to enter the promised land, there was going to take a lot of work. It was going to take some sacrifice. It was going to mean that the way that they got used to life in the wilderness wasn't how they were going to have to do life anymore. They were not going to get their hopes and their dreams fulfilled without having to change their way of life. Have you ever noticed how hard it is to change your way of life? To change your life habits? Maybe some of you have gone on diets or quit smoking or you overcame countless other forms of addiction. You know how hard it is to change your lifestyle. Sometimes it's easy to stop a particular habit, but all the things around you in your life that supported that habit aren't as easy to change. You find yourself going to all the old familiar places that support what you're trying to change. You find yourself surrounded by friends and family who expect you to do what you always did and not this new thing that you're trying to do. It's never easy. Change the life we become comfortable with. If you've ever moved in with somebody, whether that be a roommate or a spouse, you know how difficult it is to change your ways. You squeeze the toothpaste from the bottom or the middle. Does the toilet paper go over or under? You know how difficult it can be to change the habits that you grew up with, to share them with somebody else. Israel wasn't any different. Even though they probably didn't like wandering in the wilderness, it had become normal for them. A whole generation had been born and were living in that type of nomadic life. They may not like it, but it was comfortable. They knew what to expect. They knew what they had to do. They knew what it meant when they had to pack up the tent and their belongings and walk. It was all normal for them. And therefore, in that rhythm of life, they found joy. Found comfort. They found hope in that rhythm of life. And changing that rhythm to actually enter into the promised land, even though it may be the right place, boy, it was going to take a lot of change. Things were going to have to be different. Maybe you've spoken some of the same words that those Israelite spies did when it says that they made up rumors and things. You've probably said it. I know I have. We couch it in different words. Why does everything have to change? Why can't it just stay the same? Oh, I liked how we used to do that. Yeah, we've all kind of said those same things that those Israelite spies did. Seems like the obstacles before us are always bigger than the ones we overcame in the past. You know, when we look back and we say, and someone can say, boy, you've really dealt with a lot, and then, oh, that's no problem. And then we start naming, well, I had friends that helped me, or I had family that helped me, or my church surrounded me and helped me journey through that. Somehow, when we look forward, things seem to be these giant, horrible things in front of us. And the things in the past seem smaller. In the rearview mirror, they don't seem so scary. Israel was looking forward. And literally, what they say that they saw, giants, that they were like grasshoppers for these giants. So instead of wanting to move forward and to push forward to do the hard work to make the sacrifices, they were more interested in kind of turning inward, kind of that self-protection, that self-preservation. Again, maybe it's not the best, but it's the best we know, and so it's good to just say. Peter on the Mount of Transfiguration, you remember, when he saw Jesus and Elijah and Moses on the mountaintop, Peter said, oh, let's just stay here. We'll build some tents, and all of us will just stay here, and everything will be fine. Even though the charge was to go back down to the people of that. And be comfortable staying where we're at. So you can imagine the courage that it took for Caleb and Joshua, two of those spies on that trip, to talk against what all the others who were with them were saying. speak the truth was difficult. They reminded the people, the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. The Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. Now, you might expect everyone to start jumping up and down. Oh, yeah, thanks for reminding us. But no, they wanted to stone them. They wanted to silence those voices that were encouraging them. Trust in God and to move forward. The Lord is with us. Not be afraid. As God's people, we have obstacles before us. Giants, if you will. And it can feel like we are grasshoppers in this culture next to those giant things. But we must tell ourselves we are not alone. The Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. As we look towards the promised land of God's beloved community, where every knee will bow and every tongue confess, Jesus Christ is Lord. When we look towards that beloved community where God's justice and God's peace and God's grace and God's love, everything. We're facing the giants stand in our way. You know some of these giants. Societal apathy, the giants of misinformation, the giants of corporate greed, the giants of white supremacy, the giants of hate-filled self-preservation. We have every right to be frightened. But we as individuals, like mere grasshoppers, the face of giants. But friends, today I proclaim to you, in the name of the risen Christ, that we are not alone. The Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. No matter how big these obstacles are before us, the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. Now, my beloved friends, I don't want you to be fooled. I don't want you to leave here and said that the pastor just said we don't need to worry about anything, that we just kind of sit back and let God take everything. That's not what I'm saying. I don't want you to be fooled, because when we say the Lord is with us, do not be afraid, that doesn't mean the future is easy. It doesn't mean the future won't have sacrifices. For in order to face the giants, to defeat the giants, to move beyond the giants, it will take courage. It will take wisdom. It will take strength. It will take absolute devotion and reliance on God. It'll take prayer. It will take discernment. And it will take us as a community of faith working together in every way. And not just in these walls, but in this community and beyond, leaning in to the historic faith of the church, leaning into the arms of Christ. The promise of the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid means that we will overcome these giants only because God is with us. It means that we will work side by side with the Emmanuel, with the God with us to overcome these giants. We'll not always be popular. We won't always be well-liked. We will be persecuted. We will be oppressed because we choose to trust in the Lord. Not in the words, the actions, the plans of humanity. The people may even want to stone us, like they did Caleb and Joshua. But we shall persevere. Why? Because the Lord is sick. Do not be afraid. So, my dear siblings in faith, there are giants all around. There are fears. They may be very real. So is God. You must speak the truth in the face of these giants. That young boy David spoke to Goliath. We need to say, the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. The Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. Let me hear you try that. The Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. Again, the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. So say it to yourself now. The Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. Say it. Now I want you to say it out loud so those near you can hear it. The Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. For those of you worshiping online, for those of you with your smartphones right now, I want to make sure that all those people on social media, those people who are texting, those people who use email can hear those same words. The Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. Say those words. We got to speak those words. Jan and Joanne Kyle, their daughter Jody, their extended family, they're facing that giant right now. They're facing the giant of hospice and all that that represents. We need to be able to say to them, the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. On Tuesday, the Turek family is facing that giant of burying their infant daughter, Stella. And we need to be able to say to them loud and clear, the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. So many of our loved ones are facing that giant of cancer and all sorts of other illnesses that attack the body and the mind. What shall we say to them, my friends? The Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. So many of our families and our community are facing issues of poverty and wage disparity and unnecessary debt. What shall we say to them? The Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. Together we face the giant of a broken healthcare system that impacts our physical and our mental health. What will we say to those giants that deny us access to healthcare? The Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. We live in a world where it seems as if it is normal to want to take violent means to take care of our problems. There is a giant of hatred. There is a giant of intolerance. There is a giant of racism in our world today, right here in our own hometown. And what do we need to say to those giants? The Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. There are those whose children are getting ready to go off to college, and they don't know what all that means, and parents are frightened, and kids are too if they admit it, because there seems to be these big unknowns. It can be frightening and it can be scary, but we need to tell them, do not be afraid. You know what your giants are in your life. You know what those giants are. And I know that some of them are big and hairy and scary. And you don't even know how big they are because you can't see the tops of their heads and the bottom of their feet. I know that it ain't easy out there. I've got my own giants. But together, as a community of faith, we need to declare that the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. The Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. The Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. Friends, what more beautiful message shared today from the old story of Jesus' love. Says the Lord is not. Amen. What a fitting song that Julie has chosen for us to sing. God's eye is on the sparrow, and I know that God watches. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. God's eye is on the sparrow, and I know that God watches. Please rise in body or spirit, and let us sing our
thank you.
Friends, it is truth that we are not alone. The Lord is with us. We do not need to be afraid. And so it is all right for us to be generous with our love, with our grace, with our resources, whatever it may be. It is okay to share, even sacrifice by giving, because God is in charge. And God is leading us into promised land, the beloved community, where love and grace and justice abound. So today I invite you to share your offerings, whether that be your financial offerings, your prayers, your hopes, your dreams, your confidence, that we are not alone. The Lord is with us. Do not need to be afraid. If you haven't already shared your offering in the plates in the back or up here, as Dolores leads us in prayerful meditation, you're invited to come and to leave your offerings and whatever it may be in the plates up front. But know that because of you, our community is better off. If our congregations were to close their doors, this community is so much love, so much compassion, so much voices of truth. So friends, let us share our offering. Let us give to the Lord. Do not. Thank you. come now to our time of communal prayers, where we pray not simply for ourselves, not simply for those in this room or those watching online, but we pray on behalf of all the world that God's presence will be known, that there will be no fear for those God's work. God is with us. So we began this worship asking you particularly to hold Jan and Joanne in your prayers, so let us make sure that that is a powerful prayer for us. During the weeks, take the time and drop them a card, you know, give them a phone call. Jan is going to continue to be Jan until he cannot, and which means that as long as he is able, he will continue to come in here almost daily at times to do mundane things like feeding the fish, more important things like watching all the finances, but know that he is never giving up, though he is at peace with Christ. So let us don't give up on Dan, Joanne, as they journey. Also shared with you, and I share this with permission, that on Tuesday we will celebrate the all-too-short life of Stella Louise Turk as we stand with Alex and Libby as they say goodbye to their infant daughter. There are no words. There is only the hope, the truth that the Lord is with them. What other things do you come with today that we can lift up in prayer? Tony Kaysen, your oldest daughter is recovering from cancer. So again, we're thankful that she had two of them. Okay. Something that unfortunately you're familiar with. And where does she live? Memphis? Okay. And what's her first name? Ashley? Okay. So to lift up Ashley for healing from a stroke and, of course, continue you gaining your strength and Don keeping her sanity. So, other prayers that we want to lift up today? Hard sometimes in the face of what seems to be those giants, right? Even seek out the prayers, but I know they're in your heart. I know they're in your mind, and I know they're on the left. Yes, Anne? Absolutely. To be able to lift up the pandemic and its end, but the patience and the wisdom deal with it, not simply for ourselves, but for our community. Prayers for Melanie Goble as she is living through bronchitis, and remember her Celine, who had brain surgery last week or a week and a half ago. Don, would you have your hand up? Prayers for Dawn and her family as they are living through the grief of COVID in a way that some of us have been protected. If you ever answer that little box that comes on my social media once a day, if you know anybody who has COVID, you have to say yes. So someone who died from it, yes. Galaxy. Other prayers today? Let us take a few deep breaths and let us collect ourselves and to place ourselves in the presence of the Lord in whatever way that is. gracious and loving God, you are here before us. You are behind us. You are beside us. You are within us. But yet, we still feel alone at times. In this particular moment, let us feel the presence of your love and hope. As we reach out into a broken world, let us always go knowing that you are with us. We don't need to be afraid about loving, about being generous, about being kind. We don't need to be afraid of speaking the truth. Lord, you have heard things that we have lifted up to you and this congregation. You have heard prayers shared online. You know that there are many more printed in our weekly prayer list upon our hearts and in our minds. We cannot open the newspaper, turn on the news, without seeing ways in which only your presence can bring hope and healing into a broken world. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Strengthen us despite all of our frailties and our fears and even our failures. Strengthen us to be your people at work. Let us lean into one another to find the comfort we need. And together, let us be the community that you have called us into being for. Let us visit the sick. Let us welcome the unwelcome. Let us house the homeless. Let us feed the hungry. Let us sit in silence with those whom words can never meet. Let us sigh deeply with them. Grant us the courage to speak out, to stand up, to join you in creating the beloved community in our own homes and workplaces and in this community. Let us proclaim your saving grace and your eternal life in all that we do. And now, O Lord, hear us as we pray to you our family prayer, using whichever version of the Lord's Prayer is dearest to our hearts. Let us stay focused on the words we pray as we lift up to you the beautiful cacophony of your people. Let us pray. Our Father and Mother in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come, and your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from all evil. For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours forever and ever. Amen. Friends, as we prepare to leave this particular place, know that our worship doesn't end. It simply grows stronger as we go into our families, maybe out to lunch, maybe to a little wet, but a car show in the park, wherever it may be that you may be headed to. Know that God is with us. There is no need for us to be afraid. And so we stand if we are able, and we sing with our voices and with our spirits. Go now and Friends, I invite you to put one hand out with your palm up to remind yourself that you are a receiver of the many blessings of God. Place your other hand up with the palm outward to remind yourself that you are also the giver of God's blessing in this world. Let us truly go forth in peace, a real peace, peace that passes all understanding. May God's face shine upon us. May Christ's grace rain down upon us. May the Holy Spirit bind us together as siblings in faith, giving us the courage to do and to be. And let us remember those words. The Lord is with us. Do not be afraid. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.